Okay, great. I'll dive into it then. Sorry for being not as technically adroit as I should be. And that goes hand in hand with me perhaps being a philosopher. In this talk, I want to do something that philosophers do, but it's maybe not what is typically done by philosophers. So Tony Chimero, who we've been talking about a little bit, who wrote a book called Radical Embodied Cognition, talked about his love of Fodor, Jerry Fodor. And Jerry Fodor talks about speculative philosophy in one of his early books. And Tony says that he disagrees with just about everything Jerry Fodor says, but he's inspired by Jerry. So I'm inspired by Jerry too, although I'm not sure I go as far as Tony on a lot of things. But I do think there's a real role for philosophers mapping out the theoretical possibilities. And I think there's a really important role for philosophers to play as speculative philosophy, rather than just trying to provide metaphysical arguments or the like. So that's what I'm gonna do here. I'm gonna defend a speculative thesis. It's meant to be a broad speculative thesis. But it's going to be a thesis that language plays an important role in cognition. And in the process of this, I'm going to actually begin talking about or rethinking the nature of embodied cognition. And indeed, actually, after yesterday's talks, I went back and put some stuff in with a more general focus to sort of talk about some of the issues and pick up on some of the issues we talked about yesterday. So the core idea, of course, is that language is a neuroenhancement. Somehow it makes sense to think of as a way of enhancing human brains, right? In particular, I want to think of this in the context of what you might call embodied human brains. So there are two ways of thinking about neuroenhancements. The first is a kind of medical model. We think of like taking drugs to help us with memory or to think more clearly or to think more effectively or even just faster. But we can also think of about in terms of adding computational devices to our brains. We can think of this along the idea of a kind of a cyborg or some kind of assistance, right? We're talking about enhancement, so we're talking about not a replacement, say, for an artificial hippocampus or something like that, but we've talked about some way of sort of creating novel or enhanced cognitive abilities by the addition of some sort of component. So one way to think of language as a neuroenhancement is to think of it as adding to our conceptual system. So we might think of it in terms of a symbolic embodied hybrid, right? Obviously this involves some sort of commitment to embodiment. I'm gonna make such a commitment as we go along. Although I'm going to, as I said, rethink some of the ideas behind embodiment. But one way to go is a hybrid approach. And indeed, Daniel yesterday talked about, well, this might be one of those instances where hybrid theory is the best way to go. I'm actually not going to advocate a hybrid theory. So here we have a nice scene from The Terminator. And what we notice here is that there's some representation involving numbers, but then some are in language, and the idea being that there's something fundamentally added by the language. Might just make it easier to see in the movie, but if we think of it in terms of a hybrid model for cognition, the idea would be that adding a symbolic component contained within a faculty of the mind might add to our cognitive abilities. I'm going to take a different approach. So I'm going to treat it as a kind of experiential modality itself. I'm just going to treat language as a kind of constructed experiential modality. So a lot of our experience is mediated, at least through language, and it's a skill that we come about and we acquire gradually through development. And it involves, of course, action and perception. So there is some sort of conceptual reason to think that you could treat it as something like an experiential modality. So the idea is that by adding that experiential modality, we're going to enhance the capacity of the cognitive system. And in particular, I'm going to talk about concepts and semantic memory. So the idea is that the language system itself is going to play a functional role in semantic memory. And I want to talk about it in terms of an experiential resource among many. So I want to treat it as part of a kind of embodiment thesis. That's going to take a little work, and that's going to go to some of the ways in which I want to rethink the nature of embodiment. So this idea is inspired by some work by Andy Clark, and I'm often asked sort of, how does your view differ from Andy Clark? So I'm just going to begin with how it differs. And I want to just, first of all, acknowledge that some of it encompasses some of his ideas. So here's one of his statements of the role in which language plays in enhancing an embodied mind. So he talks about the computational value of a public system of essentially context-free arbitrary symbols lies in the way that such a system can push, pull, tweak, cajole, and eventually cooperate with various non-arbitrary, modality-rich, context-sensitive forms of biologically basic encoding. So the idea is that language can act as a kind of scaffold for embodied cognition, and in particular, it can form a kind of extended mind thesis for the role of language. So this has everything to do with language as being a form of extended cognition. I think that there's something to this idea, and I think it's right. I just don't think it goes far enough, and I want to take it in a slightly different direction. I want to talk about the internal effect of acquiring the language system. So the role that I want to talk about when I'm talking about it as an enhancement, it is talking about it in terms of the role that language representations play, if you want to think of it this way, internally or as part of a neural reuse account of concepts. So a way of thinking about this, I can also borrow from a work by Andy. So Andy and Chalmers, Andy Clark and David Chalmers had this famous paper where they introduced the idea of the extended mind. And they begin with a very simple, straightforward example. So the example involves playing Tetris. And they mentioned three distinct approaches to playing Tetris. The first is just to mentally rotate the item as it's floating down. And so try to fit it into where you want to find it, trying to find a target for where to move it by mentally rotating the piece and then seeing where that might fit. One of the things they note is that expert Tetris players tend to physically rotate the object as it descends. So instead of mentally rotating it, they actually rotate it as it goes down and then decide where to put it. Turns out that seems to be more efficient. Now, what they want to argue is that you're carrying out the same cognitive task, right? It just turns out that physical rotation is more important. I'm going to leave out the objections to the extended mind that Ken makes and things like that, because I'm not really concerned with that right here. I'm concerned with their third option. So their third option is the neural implant option. They use this option as a way of indicating how the brain skull barrier, right, is really not that important and relevant to the discussion. So the neural implant idea is that you would have a neural implant that rotated it, and that would have the same sort of effectiveness as the physical rotation, right? It would lead to an enhanced process, right? That would have the same effect as the physical rotation. So they use this example as a way of saying, look, the skull doesn't matter. What's interesting to me is I think there's an interesting idea here. We can think of language as a kind of neural implant, right? What happens to a neurotypical child when they acquire language is that they develop a dedicated language system. This language system is neurologically realized, has dedicated representations of processes, and those can be deployed in a way that leads to effectiveness with regard to encoding semantic memory. That's the idea. So I want to begin by talking about embodied cognition a bit, because there's going to be some work that needs to be done to think of language as a one among many embodied resources. So just to get off the ground, this is an idea that we've been talking about. The particular version of embodiment that I want to consider is not all forms of embodiment, and certainly not all forms of so-called 4E cognition, so embodied, extended, embedded, and inactive cognition. So the version that I want to think about is the idea that conceptual information is going to be stored and accessed through experiential neural systems. So this is often talked in terms of simulation. I think the simulation idea kind of imports some assumptions, but at least it involves the neural reuse of experiential systems. It's thought to help overcome the symbol grounding problem. I'm going to talk about that in a minute. And it might help explain semantic efficacy that we talked about yesterday. So there's a version of embodiment of this sort that has come to be referred to as strong embodiment. Okay, strong embodiment involves processes of neural simulation. So the idea is that we think about the world in terms of the same mechanisms that we use to perceive and act in the world. Often it's limited to modality-specific representations, not always exactly clear what counts as a modality. It's also usually considered to be fully grounded in sensory motor experience, and it's often assumed that these simulations are automatically engaged or engaged by default when processing semantic information. We've already talked about some of the evidence here for this kind of view. I want to sort of add a little nuance there and show that there are even when we're talking about that evidence, there's some issues that arise pretty quickly. So one is the evidence from somatotopy, right? Where the idea is that areas of the brain that are responsible for motor planning associated with different parts of the body are activated by concepts, action concepts that involve those parts of the body. So one thing you can look at here we have, this is from an analysis of multiple studies, and you can see the rough correlations between areas of the brain associated with different parts of the body in terms of motor action and action words. One thing I will note here is a lot of the activations found are in premotor areas, not motor areas. We may need to make our notion of modal specificity more broad, or at least to recognize that maybe premotor areas might be more relevant than motor areas, or both. We also might question the idea that there's a direct correlation between parts of the body. Right. There's a series of really interesting stimulation experiments that have led to a different concept of the organization of the premotor cortex and motor cortex. The researchers have postulated a new term, actotopy, and you see here different actions being associated with different areas of the premotor motor cortex. So. If this is a correct account of the functioning of the motor cortex, then we need to reconsider the role that the re-engagement of these areas during conceptual processing might involve. Okay, so, So now I want to talk about the symbol grounding problem. We've already had some discussions of it yesterday. There was some reference to being trapped in Searle's Chinese room. The problem is inspired by Searle's Chinese room experiment. It actually is due to another philosopher, Harnad, and he articulates the problem as it really applies to embodied cognition. Searle's problem is much more about consciousness and understanding. So one way of thinking about this is the idea that if symbol tokens get their meaning from being related to other symbol tokens, there's a problem in hooking those symbols up to the world. And we talked about this yesterday in a number of talks. One way to think of it is in terms of using a Chinese dictionary So a dictionary about Chinese in Chinese to learn Chinese, right? So you look up one symbol and you get connected to other symbols, but without having some sort of foothold into the symbol system, there's no way to understand what the symbols mean. This is meant to be a problem with a kind of purely computational approach, right? I have a picture of the Rosetta Stone there to sort of highlight, you know, how once the Rosetta Stone was effective because we, of course, were able to hook up some of the symbols to each other, but then eventually to semantic content. So Harnad claims that the assumption that many computationalists have that cognition can be developed, theories of cognition can be developed in a sort of top-down manner, and that questions of symbol grounding can be handled by sort of a bottom-up manner from peripheral experiential systems, he thinks this is just not likely to work, right? And he spends much time in his paper sort of arguing for this. He suggests that a more promising approach is to use intrinsically dedicated symbols that retain their connection to the world. And I think this is part of the core idea behind re-engagement of experiential systems. The idea is that the representations in those experiential systems are somehow connected to the objects through perception and action. And so the use of them helps overcome this problem. Because of this, the symbol grounding problem has become something of a part of the origin story for embodied cognition, at least the kinds of theories of embodied cognition that I'm talking about here. You know, you read many papers where they start off sort of just briefly describing the symbol grounding problem, and then talking about how neural simulation overcomes this problem. I actually think there's some weaknesses with the application of the problem, and I'm not the only one who's noticed this. Other philosophers have pointed this out. One problem is it's not fully clear that it solves the problem, right? Yeah, you've moved the problem to perception mechanisms, but it's not clear that how perception mechanisms necessarily overcome this, or action mechanisms. So more needs to be added to the story. People have noted that amodal theories have alternatives. If you have a theory of mental content that doesn't involve just symbol-to-symbol relationships, you have a way of getting out. So there are a number of proposals on the table. More importantly for my purposes, because I want to grant that there is some promise with addressing this problem by appealing to mechanisms that involve the re-engagement of experiential systems, is that this only excludes fully symbolic accounts. It's a problem for fully computational approaches. It is not a problem for any kind of mixed account. There are all sorts of intermediate accounts that are available. And an unfortunate aspect of the literature on embodied cognition is the overinterpretation of this problem. And I want to highlight that by considering a phenomena that I've worked on and I think is a real question mark. And I think actually the literature has really gone in this direction. So there's been a lot of work on embodied cognition and its relationship to abstract concepts. So just want to note right off the bat that many of our concepts just go beyond experience in seemingly fundamental ways. Now, I want to be clear. I'm not saying that there's just one type of abstract concept, that is a unified category. There are multiple measures for measuring abstract concepts, and they don't all agree with each other. There's some correlation, but there are differences, whether you use imageability, concreteness, body-object interaction. There's a number of measures that people can use. They're likely to be heterogeneous, right? It's not clear to me that mathematical concepts are going to be the same as religious concepts or aesthetic concepts. I don't have anything associated with a commitment to it being a natural kind. I just want to say that they highlight aspects of our cognitive system that need to be explained. And I want to just sort of highlight three problems that are posed by abstract concepts. The first is a problem of generalization, right? Some concepts are more general than others. In fact, we have hierarchies determined relative to generalization. So this needs to be accounted for, and how that might be accounted for in a system that involves neural reuse of experiential system really needs to be explained. There's a problem of disembodiment. So not only are some more general, right? Some are just fundamentally disconnected to a particular types of experiences. Finally, abstract concepts tend to be very flexible. This is something that's really missed by a lot of people talking about it, but it's an early insight. Aristotle criticized Plato on this front. He criticized Plato's arguments with regard to concepts like goodness because they had an assumption of univocality, right? In other words, the concept of goodness is relative to what you're talking about. Okay, so I think there's a kind of symbol ungrounding problem that needs to be addressed. So how do fundamentally embodied symbols, right, and I'm using that in terms of ones involving experiential systems, become disconnected from the immediate source of their grounding? I want to argue that language provides a means of doing that. So in a somewhat kind of counterintuitive way, it provides a set of embodied symbols that are largely ungrounded. So they're embodied in the sense they're associated with action and perception. They come from capacities that are acquired through experience and may ultimately involve reuse and re-engagement. But the experience they're grounded in are linguistic experiences, not direct experiences of the content, right? So the idea is that part of knowing the concept of democracy is knowing how to talk about the concept of democracy. So this requires a different conception of embodiment, and one that I think a lot of people are supporting. And so there's a lot of evidence that we need to have a more flexible, adaptive, and broader notion of embodiment. So it's sometimes referred to as weak embodiment. I'm not a big fan of that term, so I invented my own. I call it the elastic mind. So the idea here is that reuse is a fun and re-engagement is a fundamental component of our concepts, but our concepts can reuse experiential mechanisms in a flexible way. This theory appeals to kind of hierarchical representation. So they're multi-level. So they're not just primary sensory motor areas. Indeed, I think there's an important role in explaining, say, how conceptual hierarchies work by appealing to higher level representations. It might be multimodal in the sense that it might involve heteromodal and supermodal hubs. Frankly, some of our experiential modalities are fundamentally multimodal to begin with. Think about gustation or spatial processing. It's going to be flexible, so it's going to be shaped by context. So in a way, I am denying the invariant assumption behind a lot of theories of concepts. So you might wonder, am I sort of going fully ad hoc the way that Daniel talked about yesterday? I want to go part the way there, but I want to have a different kind of way of thinking about it. So I want to split the difference between default and completely ad hoc. I think there's a really nice analogy for this, and that is motor planning, right? Motor planning often involves very practiced movements, but they're always done in a context-sensitive and task-sensitive way. Think about the crossover dribble. Right? Not every crossover dribble is the same, but there are similarities. And certainly it is an entrenched capacity. I think there are other analogies that you can use. You could appeal to episodic memory and its constructive aspects if you wanted to think of it that way. Okay, so I'm running out of time here, so I want to get to the payoff. So what I want to suggest is that language is an embodied neuroenhancement and a scaffold. So I'm buying the Clark idea about it being a scaffold, but I also think it happens to be an embodied neuroenhancement. And this idea is meant to sort of bring together a whole cluster of findings that are out there in the literature. The role of iconicity in capturing concepts, the contribution of labels to generalization, the role that associations can play in capturing content, the role of constructions, metaphors, and even discourse knowledge, particularly with respect to the flexibility of concepts. I want to point out that this is an inherently a developmental approach, right? So we're talking about an enhancement that is constructed through experience, right? And so we should look to developmental data. And I think there is evidence to suggest that language plays an important role. So for instance, it appears to play a very important role for the acquisition of neutral abstract concepts, particularly starting around the age of 9. There's evidence that language appears to play a fundamental role in the acquisition of relational concepts and theory of mind, to give specific examples. I also think that one of the fundamental challenges to embodied cognition has to do with bodies. So do people with different bodies have different cognition? And this is something we need to explore. Well, one of the things that's often posed as a counterexample to embodied cognition, when we're thinking of it in terms of reenactment, is the ability of early blind participants to acquire color concepts. The evidence suggests that they might rely heavily on language and distributional properties and constructions and even discourse properties. So that fits with the idea that, you know, that's another developmental and embodied resource. There's a lot of evidence for degrees of linguistic relativity. I don't want to get into a big debate about how much to make of this. I will note that the proposal on board suggests that that relativity is going to be stronger with abstract concepts than more concrete ones. And then I want to introduce a personal note. So people are putting pictures of their children. This is my son, William. He is on the autism spectrum. He has very limited language abilities. He has very rich concepts. He's able to act intelligently in all sorts of ways, sometimes very frustrating ways. But he does not have language. So certainly he's an example of how you can get by without language. The interesting thing is to think about how language, the absence of language, and I have to say that in a matter of degree, he has some ability to understand language, what kind of effects that might have. There's all sorts of really interesting research on highly verbal people on the autism spectrum and their use of metaphor. Turns out that they seem to be bad with conventional metaphor, but appear to be very good with novel metaphor. I just want to point out that there is neuroimaging reasons to think this. I'm running out of time, so I'm going to just point out that there are recent meta-analyses that find increased activations in language areas with abstract concepts compared to concrete concepts. Again, I'm not suggesting that abstract concepts are encoded in language solely. In fact, there's all sorts of evidence that that's not true. Experiential representations such as affective representations seem to be relatively important. But I am suggesting that it's an important modality, and I suspect Penny is going to talk about this later today. I do want to recognize that there's some challenges. So one challenge is, does this elastic approach stretch the notion of embodiment too far? Frankly, I'm not sure I care. I think there's all sorts of evidence that hubs of various degrees of abstraction are involved in semantic processing. So if that leads to the abandonment of the centrality of a kind of strong embodiment, I'm good with that. If it doesn't count as embodiment, I'm not as interested in that as coming up with an account of how the brain handles semantic memory. There is another problem, and that is normally how we conceive of language is as a kind of modular and amodal system. The hypothesis that I'm putting forth denies that. The more of the story certainly has to be filled in. So what are the lessons for AI? Because that's sort of the purpose of this workshop. I want to just sort of enumerate quickly three. The first is it shows the benefit of being engaged with an external symbol system, not only in the way of situatedness and coupling, but also in terms of how that might lead to differences in internal processing. I think that the symbol system that language involves, and I mean that at various different levels, helps with generalization, disembodiment, and flexibility. And then finally, to pick up on the notion of semantic efficacy, I think an acquired symbol system can help with semantic efficacy, but remain largely pragmatic in nature. And that's more needs to be told with regard to that. So I think there's a certain power to the idea of language as a neuroenhancement. It integrates a lot of literature that I haven't, that I've only sort of touched on. I'm glad to talk about it in the question and answer period. But I think it's a way of rethinking embodied cognition. Thank you.